director of the New York Institute for the Humanities at NYU, and it's my pleasure to welcome you here tonight for our discussion of Kristin Ross's new book, Communal Luxury, The Political Imaginary of the Paris Commune. Basically, all of the fall and early spring, this is a panel I've been very excited to see come together once we scheduled it. It'd be a terrific event to have any of our distinguished panelists in conversation, but to have all of them here tonight is really a special event. So really do appreciate all of them making the time to join us, and for all of you to join us as well. In returning the words and actions of the insurgents, any number of critical themes have emerged in Kristin Ross's new book: the future of education, labor, and the status of art, the communal form and its relationship to ecological theory and practice, the thinking about what internationalism might mean in the present. And these are all guiding roles that she cited in her reapproaching the Paris Commune today. They all appear in a somewhat different historical light and framework from when Ross's first book on the Commune, The Emergence of Social Space, Rimbaud and the Paris Commune, first appeared 27 years ago. Now, after 1989, untethered from official communist historiography, an invigorating and auspicious new look at the Commune has become possible. So we really look forward to this discussion tonight. I'm going to turn things over to our moderator, Dana Polan, who is a professor of cinema studies here at NYU. But before I do, I want to thank our co-sponsors. We're happy to co-sponsor this event tonight with the Institute for French Studies and with the Humanities Initiative. And I want to thank the director of the Institute for French Studies, Frédéric Viguier, who I think is here, although I haven't actually seen him, as well as the executive director of the Humanities Initiative, Gwyneth Mallon, and the acting faculty director of the Humanities Initiative, Uli Baer. Also want to thank Verso Books for making books available, which you're welcome to purchase after the event. They're for sale outside. We'll have a brief, a brief Q&A once we finish our panel this evening, and then we hope you'll join us for a wine reception afterwards. And just before we begin, I want to ask you to go ahead and check and make sure that your cell phones are turned off. So thank you again for joining us, and now I'm happy to turn over the mic to Dana Polan. Thank you.
I'm going to read a few comments. It's a great pleasure and a source of great pride for me to moderate this discussion of the newest book by my dear friend Kristin Ross. And in a moment I'll introduce the speakers and turn things over to them, but I'm going to take the prerogative of being the moderator to actually say a few words myself. I didn't want to miss that opportunity. And it's always risky to try and summarize a rich body of work. The risk especially is that of reducing its reach, its many resonances. But let me just say that one quality that for me characterizes the importance of Kristin's work, and not just the new book, but all her scholarship, one of the things that characterizes the importance of her work is how it elaborates a new political practice in two converse yet complementary directions. That politics could perhaps be summarized by a sentence from her earlier book on the Commune, the book on the Commune and the Poetry and Poetics of Arthur Rimbaud, book, as you mentioned, called The Emergence of Social Space. In that book, Kristin intends, as she says, to, quote, document a moment or strategy in an oppositional culture that itself cannot be detected as long as one approaches cultural production uniquely from the perspective of the relentless, it couldn't have been otherwise, logic of the commodity, unquote. On the one hand, there's the attempt to perform a positive politics, a performance by actors in the past, but also by the historian who documents their efforts, or as she puts it in the first page of that early book, the historian who gathers their voices, and I like this phrase, lingers with them, this idea of lingering with voices from the past. In a wonderful phrase, the new book calls this sort of politics, quote, capacities set in motion, unquote. On the other hand, if there's this positive politics, on the other hand, there's the constant awareness in Kristin's work that any new politics cannot be constructed unless one disengages from the mythologies, the legends, the ideological thefts that dominant culture engages in with regard to progressive politics. For instance, her book on May 68 and its afterlives, her book on post-war modernity, Fast Cars, Clean Bodies, both books construct new histories, for example, a new history of May 68, a new way of thinking about post-war modernity, but they also fight against false histories and false dominant histories. For instance, the revision of May 68 into something benign for the state, or the structural rendition of post-war French modernity as the apolitical play of the signifier. In the new book, she terms the process of breaking away from legends, such mythologies, such ideologies, she calls it disidentification, and she constantly calls for disidentification with dominant approaches. She calls for the introduction of what she at one point in the new book says is a gap or division in the now, breaking away from the totality of dominant ideology. The alliance of these two moves, the performance of a progressive politics and the allied disidentification with dominant ideology, to my mind, gives Kristin's newest book much of its force. The commune offers to political practice an awareness of both internationalism and intense localism. It gives to it an awareness of ecology, ties of city and country, a universal education beyond specialization, beyond the division of mental and manual. It gives, it offers an awareness of new articulations of everyday life, art, and culture. But it does so only if one understands the commune outside state, nationalist, and evolutionary models, what she calls the dangerous integration of the commune into, quote, the liberal Republican national story, unquote. Just as in Kristin's May 68 book, where we see revolutionary impulse at risk of turning into state legend, so too the commune risks being rewritten in revisionary terms as an accomplishment precisely of the state that it revolted against. I think, for example, of Kristin's critique of the way the French Republic today imagines universal schooling as something it invented rather than an inspiration of the commune that it stole, rather than an inspiration of the commune. What on one page is a necessary clearing of terrain then becomes on the next page a positive symbolic re-envisioning. And it is in this double movement, both disengaging, clearing of terrain, but also a symbolic re-envisioning, that for me constitutes much of the beauty of Kristin's work, and that's been part of its power for me from the time we first met. So now let me introduce our speakers, and we'll go in order from right to left, although that's not political. Or from your left to my right, let's put it that way. Our first speaker will be Greg Grandin, professor of history here at NYU, author most recently of The Empire of Necessity, which I'm very excited to say is the winner of this year's Bancroft Prize in History. Next will be Andrew Ross, author most recently of Creditocracy, The Case for Debt Refusal. Andrew is a professor in NYU's Department of Social and Cultural Analysis. Then Max Tomba, who is a professor of political philosophy at Padova. He's also visiting professor at the CUNY Grad Center. His most recent book is Marx's Temporalities. Next will be Joan Scott, who is professor emerita, School of Social Science, the Institute for Advanced Studies, and adjunct professor of history at the CUNY Graduate Center. Her most recent book is The Fantasy of Feminist History, and she's working on a book on secularism and gender equality. Each person will speak for 7 to 10 minutes, approximately. One person's already asked for 11 minutes. And then Kristin will make some comments, and we'll open up to Q&A. And I remind you again that after that, we will have a party, which seems fitting for a book that's called Communal Luxury. So, Greg.
Thanks. Thanks, Dana, and thanks, Kristin, for inviting me to talk about this. It's a really, really, really terrific book. In reading it, and I kept coming back, one fact just kept popping in my head, and that was that that Salvador Allende was radicalized by an Italian immigrant anarchist shoemaker. That and the reason why I kept coming to this fact is that the Paris Commune, to a large degree, as Kristin writes, was a cobbler's revolution, because of the high proportion of shoemakers among the revolutionary dead and among the survivors. And there was one that Kristin talks about that spends a good time of deal discussing, Napoleon Guyon, who wrote a philosophical treatise on the foot. It's a great, and one of my favorite bits about the book is that the shoe should be made, quote, not for the foot as it is, but for the foot as it should be, which is a really wonderful detail. And Allende, a young Allende, would stop by the Santiago workshop, cobbler's workshop of Juan de Marchi, where he'd borrow books on Marx and Bakunin, and he learned how to play chess. And in Chile, after stevedores and dock workers in Valparaiso, is the shoemakers, as well as other artisans, printers, carpenters, and bakers who made up the core of the anarchist movement, a very vibrant anarchist movement at the time. And basically exactly the between and betwixt artisans that Kristin in the book talks about. But also I want to say that Joan Scott, in a wonderful essay with Eric Hobsbawm, talks of political shoemakers also. So there's some radical strand among cobblers. And it's not just Chile, and it wasn't just the anarchists in Latin America. Around the same time, on the other side of Latin America, or in Central America, in El Salvador, Miguel Marmol in 1932 was a 27-year-old shoemaker in San Salvador, and Marmol was a member of the Politburo of the Communist Party, the Salvador's Communist Party, which at the time was made up very much of those same kinds of artisans and craftspeople. And Marmol is famous for participating and organizing an insurrection in January 1932 against a repressive and fraudulent regime that the Communist Party tried to call off at the last minute, but it's because it seemed like the plotting was discovered. Events escaped the Communist Party's control. Popular peasant anger, especially in the country's west and rural Mayan communities, took on a momentum, and the insurrection went forward. And for days, in one community after another, experienced exactly the same kind of liberation or emancipation that Paris Communards did when they seized history. It was one of those rare eruptive moments when ideology didn't outstrip experience. Kristin writes quite a bit on what she nicely calls the dialectic of the lived and the conceived. And Salvador in January 1932 was one of those moments when the lived and conceived were in tune. And then within a few days, there was a reaction. Between 24 and 30,000, again, mostly rural Indians, were murdered in a kind of savagery that harkened back to 1871 and looked forward to the ideologically focused terror of the Cold War, where the purpose wasn't just to suppress or remove political opponents, but to transform political subjectivity and destroy socialist subjectivity. Marmol, the shoemaker, survived the firing squad that he was placed in front of by playing dead amongst the corpses, and then he went on to live a life as varied and as inspirational as the afterlife of the commune itself. He stayed in the CP, he died of old age in the 1990s, but he was very active in the FMLN in the 1980s during that country's civil war. But the point, I'm going to come back to this, but the point of Kristin's book, of course, isn't to recuperate influence or these kind of genealogies, but rather to, as Dana pointed out, to emancipate the meaning of the commune from the stultifying interpretation of both Cold War Stalinism and Republican nationalism, French Republican nationalism. The commune is good to think with, and Kristin argues that by thinking through and with the commune, we might be able to realign what the last century and a half put askew, bring back the relationship or dialogue between anarchism and socialism, not be sucked into a false debate about the state and the market, to appreciate the way the commune changed Marx's thinking, Marx himself's thinking, and perhaps most difficultly to and importantly to bring into balance the lived and the conceived, experience and ideology. In Latin America, the meaning of the commune has had a different resonance. It was never so much subordinated to official Marxist history, much less, of course, Republican history. But along with the legacy of the Spanish Civil War and Spanish anarchism, it was used, I think, to deflect away from or avoid talking about either Cuba or the Soviet Union. That is, it was a way to hold out the hope for emancipatory politics free of state repression. And today, you could see this going on today in what seems to be the exhaustion of a certain kind of state developmentalist populism, best exemplified in Venezuela. Many now point to the commune as a way out of the impasse, self-governing collectives in a free alliance with state power. There's been a lot of work, new interest in the commune as a current model of social organizing and the commune historically. The commune, Adolfo Gili, a Mexican scholar, points to debates over the commune that took place during the Mexican Revolution. particularly within the ranks of the Zapatistas, who opted not to permanently seize Mexico City, returning after proving that they could actually, that they did occupy Mexico City, returning to the countryside where they tried to build something along the lines of a rural commune. And in Chile, Ariel Dorfman, and again, this speaks more to the way that the Paris Commune has been a kind of used to frame tactics among the left within Latin America. It framed, Ariel Dorfman writes that the Paris Commune framed both sides of the tactical debate in the 1970s. For those arguing against the MIR being a kind of Cuban-inspired insurgency that wanted to forego electoral democracy, and embraced for those arguing for a parliamentary road to socialism through elections. For those arguing for the Chilean, particularly democratic or constitutional role to socialism, the Paris Commune was an example of a failed extra electoral uprising. And then after Allende's overthrow, critics of the Chilean road to socialism said that the rulers pointed the Commune to basically say, we told you so, that it would end in a bloodbath, pointing to the same Commune in the aftermath. Behind this, I think there's a deeper existential reckoning over history that Kristin describes as the Commune's either-or dialectic. There's a nice discussion in the book in which Kristin juxtaposes an either-or dialectic as opposed to a transcendental dialectic. Transcendental dialectic would hopefully move history forward to the next plane of being or consciousness of freedom. In contrast, an either-or dialectic is an existential choice, knowing that either option would more likely lead to catastrophe than next stage liberation. And Latin America, for all its innate and inextinguishable Hegelianism, its faith in transcendentalism and history as being redemptive, has lived very much this either-or-ism, this either-or dialectic that Kristin talks about. And in this sense, I like to kind of think of Latin America as the commune writ large. Ariel Dorfman writes that, you know, in response to critics of his electoralism, Allende knew very well, his answer was that he had no illusions about the peacefulness of his adversaries. And indeed, there was something very Paris Commune about Allende and the kind of solitude of history that Kristin writes about in the book, about his last moments alone in the National Palace. Patricio Guzman, a Chilean documentarian, once said that Allende's suicide shouldn't be thought of as a romantic gesture, a final romantic gesture by a revolutionary hero. Rather, Guzman says it was an act of realism. He doesn't quite explain what this means, an act of realism. But I think following Kristin, we could think about it as a synthesis of the lived and the conceived. And I think what Guzman meant was that Allende realized there was no other escape from the paradox, from the either-or paradox as life had become. He knew it to be true that democracy was both absolutely compatible and absolutely incompatible with socialism. That electoral democracy in Chile went hand in hand with the extension of socialism, both as a political form and social rights. But then those who opposed both democracy and socialism used democratic institutions to sever that relationship. And going back to that other shoemaker, Miguel Marmol, and the 1932 uprising and massacre, far from being propelled by ideology, Marmol and the Communist Party's leadership was practically paralyzed by events that had long since escaped their control. Their plunge into catastrophe contrasts nicely with George Lukács' account of Rosa Luxemburg's participation in the 1919 Spartacus uprising in Berlin. According to Lukács, at least, Luxemburg approached history with what he called clear-eyed certainty. She knew the revolt was going to fail years before the revolt actually took place. That's what Lukács says. But she supported it in any way as necessary to driving history forward towards its final reconciliation. In contrast, Marmol and the other Salvadoran communists were driven by historical contingency. They went forward knowing that that their insurrection was going to lead to catastrophe. They were driven forward by a rural social base that was demanding rebellion and retribution and restoration. And they knew that no matter what strategy they opted for, again, that either-or dialectic that seems to dominate and hover over so much of Latin American politics, the government would respond with murderous violence. I guess I just want to end here with a very brief reference to Haiti, which is barely mentioned by the communards in Kristin's book, but in a way runs through everything that they did. Kristin cites the communard Arthur Arnold writing in 1873 in a phrase that kind of resonates nicely with a lot of the book, that Paris had to be left alone. And all through her book, Kristin highlights the unprecedented and unscripted nature of the Paris Commune, that they were operating without a script, without precedent to guide action, and that it was this historical isolation was reflected in the geographical isolation. Paris had to be left alone. And every question that Kristin raises for the Paris Commune could be applied to the Haitian Revolution. How does republicanism change when one's republic is conceived as a universal one, with the threat of both insurrections was that they pushed the radicalism of the radical enlightenment forward, the first related to race and slavery, the second to class and wage labor. And then the threat of both then was the threat of the transcendent, that a new level of emancipation would be reached. So siege had to be laid, and containment and terror transfiguring the potentially transcendent into the either or, into a kind of historical solitude that overcomes Allende in the National Palace. Paris had to be left alone. When I read that phrase, again, coming from a communard writing after, summing up events a couple of years after the repression, I kept on thinking about the Haitian Declaration of Independence in 1804. We have dared to be free. Let us be thus by ourselves and for ourselves. What people have fought for us, let us walk down another path. Let us imitate those people who, extending their concern into the future, preferred to be exterminated rather than lose their place as one of the world's free people. And I think there's a lot to be said about the silence that I think exists between the Haitian Revolution and the Paris Commune, but I'll just leave it at that. It might be that isolation that accounts for the seemingly obliviousness of the communards to Haiti's precedent, but I'll just leave it there, and I think, thank you.
So I want to thank Kristin for writing this wonderful book and also for inviting us to add some comments about it here today. A couple of weeks ago, I, in my undergraduate lecture class, I asked all my students to imagine where they would be living 10 years from now. And most of them who put up their hands said they were sure they would be living in a center city location, very much like this one. There was one woman, the outlier, who put up her hand and said, I'm going to be living on a beach somewhere outside of capitalism. And I immediately thought about the movie, The Beach. Some of you may have seen it, with Tilda Swinton and Leo DiCaprio. And it's very much about the idea of living outside of capitalism. And for those of you who haven't seen the movie, let me tell you, things do not end very well. So anyway, I recommended the movie to her, but then we had a discussion about how tragic it was that she could not imagine living outside of capitalism while living inside a city, in a center city location. She concluded it could only be done if you went to the extreme margin of human settlement, the extreme edge of the physical landscape. And certainly, she's in good company historically, because a retreat from the city and its centralized commerce is a very familiar pathway for radicals looking for some alternative micro-society. That said, we live here in a city where the memory of Occupy's experiment in intentional communalism, guided by the anarchist playbook, is still very fresh and strong. For some of us at least, and for many of the young occupiers that I know, the early forced retreat from Zuccotti Park did not lead to beaches or to off-the-grid locations. Quite the opposite, it led for many of them to urban communes in carefully selected locations like Detroit or upstate mid-Hudson Valley small cities that are not yet in the throes of gentrification. Now, of course, they may still encounter the beach there, but it will be under the cobblestones, let's say, to cite the situation as slogan from May 68. Now, any comparison between the Paris Commune and Occupy, of course, is destined to be glib and worthless, and Kristin refuses to go down that route in her book, to her credit. But the book does deliver a very useful version of the origin of very important debates about communal autonomy, about mutual aid, about associated labor, about revolutionary love, that all these things that have become the default mentality for at least one generation of politically active young people in recent years. And yes, she also argues, and it's true, the past has no lessons for the future. But nonetheless, I think the book's a wonderful example of how to extract a usable archive of legacy ideas from some, you know, very distant event, another time and another place. So let me just say a few words about some of the things I like in the book. The book argues that the commune was not an isolated parochial event or phenomenon. The forces of reaction in Versailles certainly tried to portray it that way, and they tried to isolate Paris from the provinces by blocking off all the communard communications out of the city. That made it easier to recruit and mobilize soldiers from the countryside who would come in and mop up and participate in the bloody massacres that brought the commune to an end. But she makes it quite clear that this was no local event arising out of the temporary collapse of the French state. It was, in many ways, the organic outcome of many years of debates among an internationalist network of intellectuals and workers. And so that's the lead up to the commune. But the aftermath of the commune was equally internationalist in nature. And you'll find when you read the book, she does a wonderful job of following the communards in exile out of Paris when they went to London and Geneva, and also describing in some detail the very fruitful dialogue that they had, the communards in exile had with their sympathizers in London and Geneva. And these were all the important conversations. There were conversations about the nature and future of communism and anarchism, and all of the hybrids in the air at the time. There were debates about the nature and future of solidarity and fellowship. And there were debates about the self-sufficiency of the free commune, debates about the abolition of private property, wage slavery, and the centralized state. And these are all components that we've seen reemerge in the movement for the commons in recent years. So that's very, very important. Marx, Karl Marx, she's a lot to say about Marx. Marx died in 1883, so he had a limited role in these debates. But nonetheless, Kristin wants to give us a very generous account of the impact of the commune on Marx's thinking. For Marx, the commune allowed him to break with theory. He was no longer simply grappling in the abstract with Smith and Ricardo. He had before him this living, breathing example of people trying in a very unscripted way to live an alternative, non-capitalist life where the bourgeois state had been suspended, the wage labor had been suspended, and so on and so forth. And that meant, for Marx, it forced him to think about how people, the conduct of people who were behaving as if they were owners of their own lives, rather than as laborers servicing the lives of their masters. And that was a very important lesson for Marx. And in addition, towards the end of his life, and as a result of the commune, he also had to rethink Russian populism. And that to me, that was a very interesting part of the book. Peasant communalism in Russia, he began to imagine might be the crucible of a certain kind of socialist society, rather than a backward social formation, an anachronistic social formation that would be swept aside in the evolutionary progress towards socialism. Marx isn't the only person, of course, she deals with in this light. She also is very generous in her description of the impact on William Morris and Pyotr Kropotkin. And for these thinkers, the commune gave a lot of fresh life and hope to their own ideas. For Morris, for example, his ideas about useful production, and for Kropotkin, his own ideas about cooperative fellow feeling. In Morris's case, and Greg mentioned this already with the cobblers, the commune was in many ways an artisanal formation. A large number of the members of the commune were drawn from the arts and decorative industries. And for Morris, of course, this was a vision of arts and craft labor, the primacy, not the aristocracy, but the primacy of arts and craft labor. And that really turned him on, you know, for obvious reasons. And for Kropotkin, the commune was mutual aid in action, and that turned him on. It wasn't simply something that happened among animals. The mutual aid, that is, not the turning on, if you see what I mean. All right, so Communal Luxury, the title of the book. I really like this title. I like the concept. Do I 100% understand it? Maybe not. But maybe that's not all that important. But in thinking about what it is, and Kristin might give us a better summary of it, I hope she does. I think about a counterpoint, which is public affluence. And public affluence, for me, I grew up in a European social democracy, and which I thought of as sort of public affluence. It wasn't about the sharing of misery. It was a society where the state was accountable for, in some measure, for the equitable provision of public goods and for full recognition of public rights. Communal luxury, I think, is different from that. It's not just about the fair distribution of goods or resources. It's not just about the recognition of rights. It's more to do with the politics of free association and the prospect of people being able to live and act together as free autonomous individuals. And the target there, the goal there, is a quality of life. It's a qualitative goal. And by I don't mean quality of life the way that real estate brokers talk about quality of life, but something that's in excess of that. And I think it's the excess that is the luxury part, in a way. But again, I'm not 100% sure, and Kristin's going to maybe enlighten us on that. The last thing I want to say is just a few comments about the police and the army. And the police and the army are largely absent from Kristin's book for good reason. And I think to her credit, she, in order to do what she does in the book, she has to leave aside a lot of the routine obsessions of people who write about the commune and are really focused on the shifting military landscape, you know, from the seizure of the cannons of Paris to the Battle of Montmartre to the final bloody skirmishes at the end. And so I understand that, and it's largely as a result of the work that she does that I come back then to ask, you know, how is the commune to be defended? How is communal luxury, rather, to be defended? Most of the book is primarily about how it was propagated and by whom and how it was put into action. But how is it to be defended? I think it's an important question, and it could be answered all sorts of ways. Within the commune itself, of course, it was the National Guard units from working class neighborhoods who rose to the defense of the sovereignty of the commune against the army regulars from Versailles, and they were naive enough to believe that the soldiers wouldn't fire on them. But there was also a very spirited debate within the commune about what to give priority to military defense or prioritize the defense of the political principles of the commune. And as you can imagine, and understandably under the circumstances, the former prevailed. But that hasn't always been the case for groups who you might talk about who are in dissent, in the line of dissent from the communards. I mean, the Zapatista is the most prominent example, perhaps other Latin American groups that Greg has alluded to. One recent example I can think of is the Kurdistan Workers' Party. Some of you may have been following the career of the Kurdistan Workers' Party. This is a group that has renounced paramilitarism and endorsed or adopted the principles of social ecology, as advocated by Murray Bookchin, no less. Those of you who don't know Bookchin, he was arguably the finest American exponent, anarchist exponent of Confederal libertarianism, exactly the kind of Confederal libertarianism that the communards were getting at. So, like most anarchists, Bookchin felt that the state's monopoly in violence was what qualified it for its elimination. Right? This was one of the major factors in arguing the case for the elimination of the state. And if you look at the current state of luxury, where the very few live high on the hog at the expense of the very many, it's pretty clear that current state of luxury depends on a variety of heavy policing methods. We're told that the luxury that might be produced through a commune shouldn't require a lot of enforcing. But I think our experience of such situations, our experience of more direct forms of democracy, tell us that something might be required. It's not clear what, though. If not the Committee for Public Safety, then what? What is the answer to that question? And that's the question I want to leave us with. Not a question Kristin necessarily has to answer, but I want to say that I find myself asking that question as a result of the book that you wrote. So thank you.
I think there are many, many reasons why Kristin Ross is an excellent book. First of all, I think this book looks at the commune from a very original perspective. And it is a kind of, a kind of intervention in the historiography of the commune. And on the other side, this book is another kind of intervention, is a political intervention. So politically, the book goes back to the commune in order to rethink the meaning of emancipatory politics today and after, especially after 1989. There are at least two different issues that I want to consider. On the one side, I quote Kristin Ross. She wrote, "The end of the state communism freed the commune from the role it had played in official communist historiography." That means, in my opinion, that we have to put politics, and I would say even the meaning of universality or universalism, beyond the state and its juridical framework. On the other hand, the collapse or the end of the 20th century horizon of a certain idea of emancipation pushes us to rethink political praxis beyond not only the state, but beyond the means and relationship. the Commune introduced a kind of temporality that is the temporality of interruption. Or in other words, the Commune anticipates a new humanity. And I'm quoting Élisée Reclus. He said the Commune is the general word of the for calling the Commune was the Commune was a new humanity. And I think this new humanity is not an end that has to be realized. It's beyond the means and the relationship. This humanity, this new humanity, concerns a different configuration of the social, economic, and political framework in the moment of the revolutionary praxis. In other words, Benjamin would have said in the moment of the Jetzeit, in the moment of the now, of the interruption, is not a goal to realize. It's something that we can anticipate right now. And in order to show the interruption that the Commune establishes, Kristin Ross changes and challenges the usual perspective on the Commune. Kristin doesn't give us a reconstruction or a list of historical facts. Because I think, and this is my interpretation, or maybe my question to Kristin, because the historiography, the kind of historiography that she is telling does not fit in the conventional representation of the unilinear historical time. She said at a certain point of her book that for the communards, being in the present means mobilizing figures and phrases from the past. So it was an attempt to reorient modernity using the past and reinventing the past. It was an attempt to put together, I would say, different temporalities in order to open up new possibilities, new reinvention of political and social being together. And Kristin doesn't follow, or doesn't follow very much, the usual readers of the Paris Commune, like Marx or Lenin. But she looks, as I said, at the Commune from an unusual perspective, from the unusual perspective of people like William Morris, Reclus, Kropotkin, and I would add the shoemaker, Gaillard. Gaillard is, I think, is very important. This is really, for me, is a very important, very interesting entry in this book, because he wrote a philosophy of the shoe, and he claimed to bring the work of the artist shoemaker back. I'm quoting back. To the anatomical principle of the foot. I think this is not crazy and this is not romanticism. So I think Gaillard was showing and practicing an alternative poiesis, an alternative mode of production. He was challenging the oncoming serious and mass production. This kind of production was not there at the time, but he was trying to reactivate the artistic production of the artisan. So artistic production of the artisan. So the exactly the same etymology, they share the same etymology like in the ancient Greek word poiesis. And he wanted to put together these two important dimensions. So his question was, in my opinion, how to recombine in this experiment, in this interruption, whose name is the commune, how is possible to recombine work or labor and art in the in the temporal dimension of the everyday? I think it was not so different. Maybe it was of a Marx strange, weird definition of the communist society. When Marx wrote in the German ideology, communist society is hunting in the morning, fishing in the afternoon, and criticizing in the evening without becoming hunter, fisherman, and critique. And Marx was just, I think, trying to reconfigure the distinction between labor and free time. It was showing another possibility of reconfigure our everyday life in a different way, yeah, with this crazy example. But the question was very serious. It's possible to reshape this kind of distinction in the dimension of the everyday life. And so the commune, in other words, was an experiment in everyday life. The commune tried to reconfigure the distinction of working time, free time, social and political life. And I would say that the new humanity that the commune was anticipating is not an abstract word. The new humanity, in my understanding, is the new human, the new human being, that again is not a goal that has to be realized. Is a kind of new human that we can act. Is a humanity as a praxis. Is a new human that we can act right now in education, art, in everyday life, in the reconfiguration of the distinction public-private, working day, free time, and so on. And maybe I would say this is just another word. So new humanity is maybe just another word for communal luxury. This is a reinvention of our categories in a new form of being together in which art and work are not separate anymore. And okay, to conclude, just 2 minutes. And
may I? Yes.
Yeah, okay. To conclude, Kristin Ross, another quote, she brought, the commune was a new vision of a revolution based on communal autonomy. So, as I said, it was my reading of this, the commune was an experiment in everyday life, and it was an experiment in politics. And this, for at least two reasons. The communal autonomy exceeds the geographical, political provincialism of the nation space. It was an attempt to reinvent politics in the dimension of the universal republic beyond the nation state. It was an attempt to go beyond the idea of people in the sense of a nation and people's sovereignty. They reinvented the institutions, and the very important thing is they reinvented the institution by reactivating medieval institution in a new form, like the imperative mandate. So again, for me is interesting how in this interruption of the political temporality of the state, we can see how different temporalities converge in order to open up a new pathway. So in this interruption, apparently past experiments, the imperative mandate, was reactivated in order to overcome, to go beyond the political horizon of the state. And the same thing, the imperative mandate, and this is my conclusion, was reactivated in other important experiments, political experiments. It was reactivated in 1793 against the Jacobins, not with the Jacobins, against the Jacobins. And it was reactivated in the first Russian constitution in 1918. So it was an attempt to reframe politics beyond national sovereignty or people's sovereignty. And I think Kristin Ross' book is this attempt to deprovincialize both the dimension of the special dimension of politics, the nation state, and I would say even it is an attempt to deprovincialize the temporal dimension of a certain present by putting together different temporalities that can show us other possibilities and other pathways of modernity beyond the so-called Western modernity, or the dominant pathway of modernity.
I too want to thank Kristin for having written this remarkable book and for inviting me to comment on it. And I want to begin by taking a look at the cover. Not all of you have seen it. First, there's the title, which has been commented on already, Communal Luxury. For those of us well-versed in French history, the notion of luxury seems at odds with our images of the Paris Commune. I think that may have stopped you, Andrew. That upheaval following the Prussian siege of Paris, during which residents experienced starvation, eating rats, among other things, frigid winter temperatures, and terrible isolation, left little in the way of resources for the communards, whose capture of the city for 71 fateful days, from March 18th to May 28th, 1871, was ended when government forces brutally murdered thousands of the insurgents. Whether viewed as a failed but glorious working class revolution, Marx called it the Civil War in France, or a step towards the consolidation of the French Republic, luxury and the Commune seem an odd, even an oxymoronic combination. And then there's the design. The choice of the backdrop, the design by the English artist and socialist and the supporter of the Commune, William Morris. It's beautiful to behold, but I have to say neither the bloody red that I expected and that seems more appropriate both for the flag of the insurrection and for its repression, nor maybe for the menacing black flag that we might associate with the anarchist tendencies often attributed to the militants. When I got the book in the mail, I had read the book in page proofs and blurbed it. When I got it in the mail and saw this cover, I found it jarring. I just thought, no, why did they do that? And then I began to think about it, and I thought, well, it was entirely appropriate, because what it does is it alerts the readers to the fact, at least those of us who know anything about the Commune, that something radically subversive awaits us in its pages. Not just radically subversive, but strangely comforting. The decorative beauty of the cover has something to do with the vision, the political imaginary that Kristin Ross evokes and that she hopes will inspire us to think differently about our present. The phrase communal luxury comes from a manifesto by the Federation of Artists in April 1871, and this is the quote, "We will work cooperatively towards our regeneration, the birth of communal luxury, future splendors, and the universal republic," end of quote. This refers, Ross tells us, to the opening of possibility, the fruits of a collective endeavor based in daily practice, something that will exceed, and I think Max's use of the term exceed, something in excess of any known form. And this is a quote from Kristin, "More important than any laws the communards were able to enact was simply the way in which their daily workings inverted entrenched hierarchies and divisions, first and foremost among these, the division between manual and artistic or intellectual labor. The world is divided between those who can and those who cannot afford the luxury of playing with words or images. when that division is overcome, as it was under the commune, or as it is conveyed in the phrase communal luxury, what matters more than any images conveyed, laws passed, or institutions founded are the capacities set in motion. You do not have to start at the beginning. You can start anywhere, end of quote. Communal luxury, she tells us, is realized best in small-scale communities, where Morris, for example, noted that, quote, one can take pleasure in all the details of life. Pleasure is synonymous with the invention of solutions to problems that are unhampered by bureaucracy or reason of state. Solutions arrived at cooperatively, those future splendors in the quote from the artist, reflecting shared practice and with little or no regard for rules imposed by the market, the nation, or the state. The universal republic is not the French nation state, the embodiment of homogenizing general will. Rather, it is again a quote, and this is a quote, rather it is a voluntary federation of free associations existing at the local level. A federation in which, as Max Tomba has put it, referring to an earlier revolutionary moment in French history, there is a notion of universality, quote, in which differences are not eradicated but reconciled. No homogeneity of the population in a nation state, but differences recognized in a heterogeneous cooperative association. By freeing itself from the power and authority of the state, Ross writes, the Paris Commune offered, quote, a new vision of revolution based on communal autonomy and the loose federation or association of these autonomous units, end of quote. The associational theory articulated in the practices of the communards, cooperative workshops, childcare for women workers, novel methods of education that assumed equal intelligence for all men and women, and many other non-state institutions, all of this inspired the thinking of intellectuals and activists beyond Paris and well after the uprising had been defeated. Ross reminds us that the Commune had an important impact on Marx's understanding of the transformative potential of peasant communes in Russia, and she details the lines of transmission from participants in the Commune to Marx and to others like Kropotkin and William Morris. In this book, ideas are not disembodied philosophical principles, but the fruit of quotidian practices that then travel in the persons of political intellectual actors. Theory is arrived at, as it were, from the bottom up. Ross has returned to the Commune some 25 years after she first wrote about it because, she tells us in the introduction, it seems to have a particular relevance to the way we might think about politics today. Quote, like Walter Benjamin, I believe that there are moments when a particular event or struggle enters vividly into the figurability of the present, and this seems to me to be the case with the Commune, end of quote. She outlines many similarities between that 19th century uprising and today's political concerns. Again, a quote, the problem of how to refashion an internationalist conjuncture, the future of education, labor, and the status of art, the commune form and its relationship to ecological theory and practice, end of quote. There are also the Occupy movement and similar efforts to forge solidarity across the lines of race, class, sex, and nation, efforts that suggest an opening to possible futures inconceivable within the terms of the ideologies of neoliberalism and national sovereignty. Nonetheless, I read Ross less as advocating specific communard solutions to contemporary problems than as a reminder that certain historical moments open unforeseen possibilities for thinking differently about our futures. Her revisionist reading of the Commune points out that in the face of huge political crises of capitalism, of national identity, of war, alternatives were offered that envisioned new and different worlds. Those alternatives were foreclosed by massive repression and then by historians who interpreted the Commune in the light of the seeming inevitability of what came after it. This in turn led to a forgetting of the radical nature of what was implemented for a brief period, a non-state solution at once local and universalist, mobilizing individuals to attempt to bring into existence then and there, not in some distant utopian future, a more just and egalitarian world. It's interesting to me that Ross's book joins a few other recent histories that draw attention to similar moments of possibility that have been overlooked or misunderstood because they were so quickly foreclosed. Here I'd cite Gary Wilder's Freedom Time, Negritude, Decolonization, and the Future of the World as one example, and Max Tomba's work on insurgent universality in the French Revolution as another. Wilder writes about, quote, unrealized attempts by French, African, and Antillean legislators and intellectuals to invent forms of decolonization that would secure self-determination within the old framework of the empire without the need for state sovereignty, end of quote. The proposals of Aimé Césaire and Léopold Senghor, he writes, reconceived empire as a collection of territories equal in status, collaborative associations devoted to advancing common interests. And Tomba alerts us to the moment in the French Revolution when the abstract bearers of rights invented by juridical universalism were replaced in the political imaginary by references to, quote, particular and concrete individuals in their political and social agency. This is a critique of prevailing liberal concepts of citizenship, one that Tomba notes, quote, opens up the political form of the state and introduces possibilities for radical social and political change. Like Ross, these scholars point to the fact that thinking about alternatives to liberal ideas of national sovereignty was not only possible, but practiced, literally implemented on a local scale in the commune, written into the Constitution of 1793 during the revolution, and part of a political program that was offered as the alternative to national liberation for post-colonial identity in the 1950s and 60s. There was also, in all of these moments, a rejection of the homogenizing impulses of universalism, its resort to abstraction to occlude but not overcome social hierarchies, in the name of a universality that embraced difference as a shared human experience. This was a common project, if you will, a recurrent political imaginary. What does it mean that we now have a critical scholarship that turns to these moments of foreclosed yet well-articulated alternatives to the state, and to equally repressed concepts of universality that reject universalism's exclusionary precepts? How do these critiques of the necessity of the state form and of its accompanying universalism open us to thinking our futures differently? Does there lie in these histories some inspiration to think outside the box of what Wendy Brown in her new book, Undoing the Demos, Neoliberalism's Stealth Revolution, refers to as neoliberal rationality? I understand, Kristin, your argument about the parallels between the commune and our own time, but I wonder, beyond those specific parallels, how do you think about the place of this kind of history in the construction of our own political imaginaries? Is your book, and these others as well, doing some of the work Brown calls for as an alternative to despair? And I quote Brown, the very end of her book, tasked with the already difficult project of puncturing common neoliberal sense and with developing a viable and compelling alternative to capitalist globalization, the left must also counter civilizational despair. Our work on all three fronts is incalculably difficult, bears no immediate reward, and carries no guarantee of success. Yet what apart from this work could afford the slightest hope for a just, sustainable, and habitable future, end of quote. I take communal luxury to be doing this kind of work, urging us not so much to imitate the commune itself as to realize that there are alternatives to the stories we have been told about what the necessary and inevitable shape that human association must take in the form of capitalist economies and the nation state. It's a call, this book, your book, that alerts us to the possibility that in moments of crisis, there are openings to think differently that we can and indeed must pursue.
I will now invite Kristin to respond.
Well, I'm not going to speak for very long. There's so much to respond to. It's such an honor to have such interesting readers. Just to begin with Joan's ending, it's, you know, I this business about the past and whether or not it gives us, teaches us anything, or whether the past has a pedagogical relationship to us, is, I've always thought that it doesn't, and that that the past actually teaches us nothing, and so then why bother with it? And I think that the reason for me does have something to do with that. That way in which, even if there are no morals to be drawn or no lessons or any of this, there's still what thinking about an event like that does is it makes us aware of the moments in our present that are contingent when we can make choices, and it allows us to recognize those moments more clearly. And that's about all I would say, because I think you all have just wonderfully summarized what I tried to do in thinking the commune both as something that is gone, it's in the past, it belongs to the past, and yet I also tried to think of it as a kind of opening up of future possibilities, or possibilities in our future that that we can think about. And I think my own relationship to thinking about history and historical processes was deeply changed when I happened upon the early works of Jacques Rancière and Révolte Logique Collective in the late 1970s, and I translated some of them, and it was really from that group, that collective group that came out of 68, and it was very much a part of how to write history differently after 68, of which there were enormous numbers of experimentations, not just history from the bottom up, but theory from the bottom up too. And it was there that I learned that the voices or the subjectivities of workers in the past merit as much of our attention as do the people who make theories about those workers today. And so so in my research, of course, I paid a lot more attention to the actual works by commune arts rather than works about them. And that's part of the clearing of the terrain that I think Dana mentioned, that I did quite brutally, in the same way that I just threw out everybody. I didn't care what Mao said about the commune or Trotsky or anybody like that. I thought, why not? Given it's the same sort of radical gesture that the commune arts themselves performed when they decided to get rid of what William Morris called that base piece of Napoleonic upholstery, the Vendome column, and just, you know, clear it away. So I think that is definitely part of what I was trying to do. And then the second thing is also about when you go back to these situations in the past, these workers, and if you want to see them, if you want them to become visible as subjectivities and not just as data, that's the danger. If you recreate the actual phenomenology of something like commune art culture, you have to denaturalize their conditions. Otherwise, those workers are simply going to be the naturalized expression of their conditions. And if they're that, then we won't be able to see them. We will only see data. And so I think that is the main thing that I learned from the Révolte Logique Collective and the way they went about things. And in order to denaturalize, you then have to set up these you have to stage things, really. You have to place things horizontally next to each other that have not been put together before, which is why I bring in someone like Morris. And what that does is, you stage these encounters of phenomena or of characters or of events, and then you have to listen very carefully to the dynamics that result when you put these two unexpected things together. And sometimes that means, just as I say, taking all of the old clutter off of the stage completely. And an example of that would be, the way that we think about the politics of the period after the commune as being dominated by the rivalry between Marx and Bakunin. And it's what happens if you just push those two old bearded guys off the stage, and what can you see? And what becomes visible is, in fact, a whole amazing political discourse, which is what I tried to, what Andrew spoke about in the second half of the book, what I tried to talk about, where you have people who are not they're not slavishly allegiant to either Marxism or anarchism, but are actually doing a form of bricolage, theoretical bricolage, and putting the two together. And I think this is a project, now this is a project that resonates very much, I think, with what a lot of people are trying to do today. So that's something. And what that amounts to is, I think, that what Max was saying, that my avoidance of unilinear time has to do with a kind of paratactical method that I've tried to describe. It's a horizontal method more than one of sort of moving straight forward through time. And then I think I will say something about, Greg, Latin America as the commune, I think, is too big. I think we just have to talk about Uruguay. Because certainly by the end, they didn't have a fetishism of the small, but they definitely were very attentive to the question of scale. And by the in these conversations in the mountains of Switzerland that I end with, one of the things they're very clear about is that these social entities have to be small enough so that people are directly involved in deciding things at every level of everyday life. And that was the definition of happiness for Morris, that kind of attention. So I'll conclude, because I think everybody wants to have a drink, with trying to say something about both the title and the cover. They were both a fight, and my editor, Adverso, definitely wanted Guys on the Barricade as the cover. And I said, no, how about something from like a William Morrison design? And he said, don't you think that's too twee? And then as for the title, too, there was a lot of debate about that. And the French refused. They refused Communal Luxury. They shortened it to L'Imaginaire de la Commune. They took out the luxury. And the reason that they said, and this, I had to give in with the French, because the French, it's not my language, but what they said was that in France today, the contemporary understanding of the word commune or communal is simply limited to the municipality. And it has, and so, you know, people would just start thinking about very boring things like municipal elections or, you know, the things that make you want to die.
What about the political imaginary?
Well, that, I don't know about that. Joan mentioned where the phrase comes from. And I was always very struck by the phrase. And when the artists used it in their manifesto, it's clear that they meant something like the idea of public beauty. So not public affluence, Andrew, but public beauty. And that, so the public beauty in the sense of the right of everyone to live and work in an agreeable environment, or the idea that public spaces should be rendered beautiful, and that that beauty should not be privatized. That so this could seem like a very minor sort of demand, especially when people were eating the zoo animals or you know whatever. But this is not actually the case, because if you really think about what it would mean were we to have something like public beauty, it would be a complete alteration of every aesthetic parameter of our lives, and it would be the undoing of the opposition or the division between those who do and those who don't have the luxury to play with art or to play with images or to play with words. So that was one of the things that was in the heads of the artists. But there was a polemical dimension again. And I think that that is very important right now, because I think what the Versaillais were very busy doing a lot of propaganda in the countryside, telling the peasants and the farmers that they wanted to create the idea of a kind of miserabilisme, you know, like the wretchedness of communist life, these communists that had seized the city. And so the communards replied with the idea of communal luxury in order to show that sharing does not have to mean sharing misery, which is what, you know, which is what the Versaillais were trying to say. So there's a very polemical, there was a polemical dimension to it as well. But ultimately, I this is where the book opens up into the way in which a lot of this thinking leads directly to a kind of ecological thought and the beginnings of an ecological program. Ultimately, it's really about finding another measure of social wealth. You know, finding, trying to decide what a society means by luxury, or what it values, what it considers precious. Finding another measure for what is precious other than that of the market. So I think all of that is there in the phrase, and I think it's the anti-miserabilisme one, I think, is quite nice now when we have states redistributing wealth to each other in the name of austerity. It's actually kind of a somewhat of a timely notion. Thank you.
We'll maybe entertain two or three questions, not many more. And there is a microphone to be passed around. Does anyone want to ask a question?
Hi, Kristin. My question is if you could just talk a little bit about some of the unexpected afterlives of the communards that you discovered in your research. For example, I've read somewhere that some veterans, you know, decades later were taken to the Soviet Union as kind of like museum pieces to like talk to young revolutionaries in the 20s, and you know, in some of these party congresses that brought people from the Caribbean and wherever else. So I wondered if you encountered anything like that or whatever, that where people went and did unexpected things afterwards or ended up in unexpected places.
I do try to follow out what I think of as certain key transversals that are formed. Like the figure of Elizabeth Dmitriev is fascinating. She's 18 and manages to unite the two most important political thinkers of the time, Chernyshevsky in Russia and Marx, simply by moving between them, and then ends up in the commune where she, along with seven textile workers, founds the Union of Women, which is the most important and most effective organization in the commune. So even before there are these kinds of amazing movements on the part of individual communards. And this comes back to the internationalism that is so striking. The historians who talk about the internationalism of the commune, they generally just count up how many Italians were there and how many, you know, the Polish generals always are mentioned, and yet I think it's much more interesting to see the movement of ideas and actual, you know, encounters between people both before and after, which is why I opened up that time period of the 72 days. I don't know the story you're talking about the people in the taken to the Soviet Union. You know, the group that I found the most interesting were the refugees in Switzerland, and they are working with Élisée Reclus and Kropotkin, and this is really now I think what people interested in ecological theory have gone back to this group in particular as the founding of social ecology. And when I wrote about Reclus, you know, 25 years ago, nobody was looking at him, hardly at all. And now he's at the center of a whole bunch of ecological theory that they say, you know, this died out in the 1870s and didn't come back until Murray Bookchin in the 1970s. I mean, there was a 100-year gap in the thinking. So that group is interesting to me.
Other questions? We'll take one or two more if there are.
I wonder if you see any connection between the concept of communal luxury and the American anarchists' call for bread and roses. This was Emma Goldman and the women who worked in the strikes in Massachusetts. It was always bread is not enough. We have to have roses too.
Mm-hmm. Sure. I mean, there's a deep kind of it was really Henri Lefebvre who began, I think, to show us a little bit of and he's the source of that phrase that Greg and Andrew used of the dialectic of the lived and the conceived. You know, so that. And by that he meant that, you know, revolutionary thinking and revolutionary acting are obviously very different, but they need to come back towards each other regularly to be renewed. And he also believed that it's actions that create dreams and not the reverse. Mm-hmm. It's the excess of a movement that creates theory, what Joan mentioned as theory from the bottom up. And I think that's definitely there in the Goldman as well.
Let me invite you all to go next door where you can congratulate Kristin individually and look at her book, which is a great book.